So today I will introduce one specific problem. Okay, in fact, you can expect this kind of problem in examination too. But I don't think you'll have an examination right now. Okay, only in the towards the end we have. But you have quiz-based assessment and all is there. Okay. So, but anyway, this is something I would like to introduce you to. So the last class, what did we learn? We learned about the fuzzy logic. Okay. Another Karthik, summarize from what you need to summarize what we have learned in the last class. Can you recall that? Krishna?
Sir?
Yeah, one of you try to summarize, yeah. Suruparan? Anyone? Varsha?
Yeah. Sir. We saw how
what happened? I didn't hear anything. Yeah, anyone else? So I said about something like, am I audible, guys? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Okay.
Hello, sir.
So we discussed something related. Yeah, please proceed.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah,
sir. Sir, last class, we saw that how we can replace a controller with a fuzzy logic thing, and basically, fuzzy logic does what a controller does, but in a more human approach, sir. It's not
very good. Human reasoning based approach.
Precise. Yes, sir.
It's more kind of precise, but not accurate. Okay.
Like that.
Not accurate, but it is precise. But you will collect expert knowledge. That's a key point I said. Expert knowledge. So in terms of linguistic terms, okay, the person will tell I'll increase or decrease, all those things. You know, you collect that kind of knowledge that you call it as expert knowledge. And you try to frame the rule base based on the membership values you assign. For example, the error can be one of the input to your fuzzy controller. Okay? So error can be classified into positive error, zero error, negative error, like that, and you assign membership values. And then we also seen we can use a toolbox available in MATLAB for designing this kind of controller. It's called fuzzy toolbox. Okay? It's a very powerful tool. It's a very good, excellent tool. In fact, for quite long years, people have been using for even for research. Students are using. Okay, so you can also try that. It's a quite easy way in which you can approach the problems. Okay, fuzzy toolbox in MATLAB. So then we have seen how you can apply it for replacing conventional PID controllers with fuzzy inference based PID controller. Okay, so with that, I'm not going to go deeper into fuzzy logic now right now. Okay, I'm stopping it here. So we'll go back again to the unit one and continue with our neural network design. Ideas. Okay, this I have given these two lectures. Past two lectures I have given only to give an exposure to fuzzy logic, so that you can also think in that direction. You can start doing some kind of homework from your end. If you are interested in this technology, maybe you want to work in this technology for your project or something. Maybe you can start doing your work using start with MATLAB. Okay, MATLAB fuzzy toolbox. The documentation of the fuzzy toolbox, now you can read that once. If you can read that, it's a very simple language, very lucid way that documentation has been prepared. So anybody who is interested in this domain can read that documentation. It's available online. Go to www.mathworks.com, okay, and you can get that documentation. Or otherwise, open the MATLAB and see the documentation directly. You can see. If you have MATLAB installed in your computer, you can see the direct. Okay, fuzzy tools. Okay, so that's one thing I'm telling you. Now let us move ahead and try to work out a problem today on linear regression. So linear regression, in fact, I said maybe I will introduce some of the study materials so that you can also go through it, okay, in your free time. There are some mathematical insights based on statistics for linear regression. Those who are interested can go through that. Okay, those who are not interested, follow the lecture. Okay, So now statistics is some area directly connected to statistical learning. They call it neural network. They call it statistical learning, another name. But as soon as you enter machine learning, okay, to talk about big data, I said. So statistical learning, basically you work with some the data size is not big, not huge, okay, like a big data is. Okay, but our foundations for neural network or foundations for machine learning, everything stems from what? Statistics. So I am introducing you today to two professors. Okay, you can go through their website also. There is a book titled "An Introduction to Statistical Learning." Okay, a professor, Trevor Hastie, Robert Dipshirani, Daniel Orbiton, and Gareth Chips. This book is available free. Okay, for anybody can download this book from the internet. Okay, so you can visit this website. Those who are interested, okay, so you can visit this. Just type "statistical learning" free book. Okay, so this book is available online free. These professors are there giving it free. Okay, it is not that somebody has hacked and somebody is using that illegal copy or something. They themselves, they have announced it very clearly. You can normally call it as ISLR book. You just type in ISLR. Okay, ISLR. This book titled "Introduction to Statistical Learning." Okay, using R or the elements of statistical learning. Two books they are published. Both the books are available free. Okay, anyone can download and they can use it. The key point is these professors have also given a set of video lectures to complement their book. Okay, so that website is this: YouTube Statistical Learning. Okay, and here you can see all the lectures. Playlist. If you go to the playlist, you can see lesson 1, 2, 3 like that. Okay, all the lectures. All very short lectures, in fact, one or 20 minutes, 15 minutes, like that. Maximum 12 minutes, yeah. 12 minutes, 18 minutes, like that. Easily you can go through. This book is what I'm telling you. Okay, so you can go through this book, okay, this book and this study material. Okay, and then you also have the books can be downloaded here also. These are all some websites you can go and download the book. So in today's class, my aim is to introduce you to the differences between linear and logistic regression. Okay, what is the difference between linear and logistic regression? So if you read this web page, okay, so you just type in Google differences between linear and logistic regression. So we already have been discussing about it. Okay, so this particular web page can give you more insights. Just type in Google, okay, difference between linear and logistic regression, HTML file will get a lot of sites. They give a lot of detailed kind of analysis between finding the differences between the linear regression and logistic regression. So we are quite comfortable with this kind of graphs. Okay, no. So in the case of linear regression, we are trying to fit in a line. Okay. Okay. We have a continuous dependent variable and independent variables can be continuous or discrete by using best fit straight line. Okay, that's what we are trying to do here. Linear regression contains only one independent variable, while multiple regression contains more than one independent variable. The best fit line in linear regression is obtained through the least square method. So I'm going to introduce you that today. So how we are going to fit data for a given kind of data set. So we have seen the examples for logistic regression. Professor Capra has, Nitish Capra has introduced you to that idea, logistic regression. So we know this kind of expression, logistic sigmoidal function we'll be using, 1/1 plus exponential. And I told you this is a more kind of a probability. Okay, the some data will be here, some data will be here. We are trying to fit a line, we are trying to fit a curve, the logistic regression curve. Okay, the sigmoidal function curve. You can see this particular class you can classify here and some classification you can. So this is a zero class and this is a one class. So in between you have all the varieties of class between 0 to 1. But in the regression you have all continuous variable numbers. It is not between 0 to 1. Okay, so we are trying to fit a line through points. So that's a regression point. But logistic regression is slightly counterintuitive. So this logistic regression plays a role of classifier only. It's not regression exactly. Okay, so you have to understand it clearly. It's counterintuitive. The name says it's logistic regression, but it's not doing a job like this. It's not a regression job. It's doing, in fact, a classifier job. It's trying to identify classification between two different set of classes. Okay, 0 and 1 here. Okay. So the key differences, maybe you can read it out. the linear regression models data using continuous numeric value. As against logistic regression model, the data is the binary values. Linear regression requires to establish the linear relationship among dependent and independent variables, whereas it is not necessary for logistic regression. In the linear regression, the independent variable can be correlated with each other. On the contrary, the variable must not be correlated with each other. Okay. So we'll see some examples, and you can understand these three points. Okay. We have some other material also. Here it is the case. Here again, you can see the two curves. In linear regression, the outcome is continuous. In logistic regression, the outcome has only a limited number of possible values. The dependent variable here is the logistic linear regression is used when your response variable is continuous. Okay. Then some examples are here. We'll take two examples. The professors have given the slides also. Maybe you can go through the slides also. Along with video lectures, you can download the slides. Okay. So linear regression is a very simple approach to supervised learning. So here you say x input is output y. X, y, we are trying to fit a line. We'll take up an example here. Can somebody read out this slide for me? Guruburan, can you read this slide? Or Varsha, someone. So we have an advertising kind of a data. Okay. So we are looking for some kind of questions like this. Is there a relationship between advertising budget and sales? How strong is the relationship between advertising budget and sales? Which media contribute to sales? How accurately can we predict future sales? Is the relationship linear? Is there synergy among the advertising media? So these kind of questions normally data scientists normally they ask based on data set they have. So look at the kind of data set we have. So we are having TV. Okay, based on TV, how the sales is related. This is more of a kind of a interrelationship between the advertisement happening through TV, how it is influencing the sales. Radio, how it is influencing sales. Newspaper, how it is influencing sales. We have data set like this. So we'd like to predict, okay, in the future, for example, this number goes, okay, the advertisement, 50 advertisements they're going to give through radio. What will happen if I give 100 advertisements? How the sales will improve? If I want to study that, I'll go for putting a line through the points. Okay, so we fit normally this kind of expressions. This we are already quite comfortable. So this kind of a problem, you call it as regression problems. Okay, so we have continuous time of data. It's not between two classes. It's between, we are trying to fit a line through the points. Okay, it's a continuous data points we have. Okay, that's why we call it as, we call this kind of problem as a regression problem. Okay, so here we are accumulating all those errors between the line what we draw and the data set what we have. And we try for each point we have an error. Okay, we square the error and we try to minimize. Identify a particular value for this beta 1, beta naught, so that this error is minimized. Okay, that's the kind of problem we are talking about. Are you getting the point what I'm saying? Anyone having difficulty in understanding it, what I said right now? Any difficulty? What we are trying to do? Anyone can tell me? We are trying to identify these two parameters, beta 1, beta 1. Okay, that's what weights and biases, we know that. So identify these parameters so that we'll get the least squared value of errors. Residual sum of squares of the errors will be minimum. That's what we are trying to achieve. Here we are going to employ something called least square approach. Okay. So the least square approach is more like this. In fact, we learned it for the gradient descent approach for classification problem, the perceptron and all those things we learned. The least square approach is something more similar to that only. Okay. But here, in fact, we are going to accumulate error for each error point. I'm going to square all those errors and I'm going to minimize it. So let us see how we can do that, least square approach. But before doing that, I'll show you also one more slide on classifications. So the classification problem is more like email problems, spam and harm. Okay. So that's we are tracking about the probability of that X belongs to a particular category. The sigmoidal functions, remember. Okay. So here we have. So it's more kind of linear discriminant analysis, normally they call. And it also comes up with another name for it, the logistic regression. It's different from linear regression. Here is a logistic regression model. It and sigmoidal functions. So we have a particular class here, another class here. So with the logistic regression curve, we are trying to find out the probabilities. Okay. It's more kind of maximum likelihood approach it is. We'll see that later on, maximum likelihood. This stems from maximum likelihood. It means what? Identify a particular parameter, beta naught, beta 1, so that the probability of the particular data set, particular data point of getting a class 1 is going to get increased. Okay, it's called maximum likelihood. Maximum likelihood means what? For the given parameters, that particular data set is going to occur. That particular data set will belong to a particular a class. It may be either 0 or 1. So you are trying to maximize that likelihood. By varying that parameter beta naught, beta 1, identify for which particular value for beta naught, beta 1, this you are going to get the maximum probability of occurring of that particular data. It may be class 1 or class 0. Okay, so that's the kind of problem you're talking about. So it's more kind of probabilistic approach. Okay, so you'll see that again when we are going to discuss about the maximum likelihood prediction. Today's class, we are more focused on regression with least squared solution. Maybe in one or two classes after, we'll be talking about this maximum likelihood for classification problems. How we are fixing our beta naught, beta 1. Okay, so with maximum likelihood approach. So then later on, we'll go for the gradient descent based backpropagation learning network for multilayered perception. Okay. With that, we'll wind up the first unit. Maybe another 5 or 6 classes we will take for winding up the first unit. Okay. So with that in mind, let us now proceed and take up the problem of least square based approach for a given regression problem. Okay. Data set is more like this. So we'll take up our own problem, okay, difference equation problem. I hope you're all quite familiar with this right now. Okay, B1 is what? B1 is associated with UK minus 1. It's a difference equation. So this is a difference equation we have. So we have a dynamics given by yk plus a1 yk minus 1 is equal to b1 uk minus 1. We are talking about a system again. We already discussed about this kind of problem before. So I am trying to put it from linear regression perspective, this problem. Okay. So we have output yk for the system. Two inputs. What are they? Uk minus 1, yk minus 1. And I would like to find out the parameters A1, B1. We already had a discussion on this. Find the estimate of A1. So we write the system of equations. So how do we get all this data? U minus 1, Y minus 1, Y 0. U 0, Y 0, Y 1. How do you get all this data? How do you get? Data points, how do you get? Any idea? How do you get these data points? Anyone? Guruvaran? Harsha? Ananta? Abhijit? So I give you a system, okay? And I want to collect all this data. What do? U of k minus 1 is what? Input to system. U of k minus past output. How do you get all this data? Anyone in the class? For any system, how do you collect data?
By noting down the data.
Yeah, how do you collect? You conduct experiment, okay? You have to
giving random inputs.
Yeah, random inputs, good. Okay, you give inputs and then you collect the data. Okay, that's what I'm asking. Okay, so now once you collect this data and you can fix your time also. Okay, k for different values of time, you're going to give all this data. The k value is fixed. Okay, means 0th instant, 1st instant, 2nd instant, 3rd instant. And these are all the inputs. U1, you get the output y1, you get the output y2, all these data points are there too. Now what you are expected to do, you are expected to compute the dynamics. A1 and B1 you need to know. So now let us define set of expressions. This is what I want. This theta, I don't know. do not, I don't know this. I need to find out this. Okay. And this Y, they are the outputs that I already obtained data. Data point in hand. Okay, now I'm defining some pi. Okay, this pi is more like this. Pi is equal to some psi transpose 0, psi transpose 1. This psi transpose 0 is nothing but minus y0 ug. So that I can easily write a system of equations in terms of a matrix like this. What is this matrix clearly? Can you see the matrix clearly? A1 and B1. Okay, so I have system of equations like this. The system of equations, I have put it in the form of matrix like this. Okay, pi theta. So y0, for example, I want to have, then it should be equal to minus y of A1 y minus 1 plus B1 u minus 1. That's the first data I have. Okay, so I'm starting from 0 point. Okay, so then it goes on y1 u1. It goes on up to yn minus 1, the last point. It will go here. If I want to yn, I need to have these two data. Okay, so these are all the two unknown parameters I have, a1 and b1. How do we solve this problem using least squares? That's the goal. Okay, in fact, using gradient descent based iterative algorithms. Iterative based gradient descent. We already solved this problem. I hope you can recall that. We already solved this by using, what is the formula? Can you recall that? W nu is equal to W old plus learning rate times rho e by rho w. We worked out this problem already. In iterative manner, we can work out. Every time we can iterate based on the data set, we can work out this and we can collect values for W1, W2, like that. Now I am going to work out in the form of a least square based solution, linear regression based least squares approach. So how I am going to do? I am going to take completely the data. Okay, all the data points I have, and I have got this expression with some error. Okay, because the measurements are always you are going to measure this output, na? It's always prone to errors. So I'm going to have this expression. So these errors, I'm going to call it as E1 for the first data point, E2 the second data point, En. So I have n data points, n measurements I have. Okay, so I'm fixing my objective function like this. And I'm going to square all the data points. So what is the expression I'll be getting? So this y, this is what? Experimental outcome. We know that. And this pi theta is the regression expression, regression equation. The prediction comes from the regression equation. So this theta, we need to compute. We don't know. Okay, we don't know this expression. So now I'm trying to find out, this is as a whole, this is error transpose, this is error. So this error transpose error, inner product, I'm going to have the J, the objective function. Anybody having difficulty in understanding till this point, please ask what we are trying to do. The same manner, neural network based approach, least square approach is, the way I'm telling all this is, these ideas stems from least squares. Okay, so that's why we are going for. Now up to this, any doubt you have? Can you see the problem formulation clearly? What we are trying to do? We are trying to identify or model the system dynamics. What's the big assumption here? The assumption is, I am believing that my model is like this. It's the first order model. Okay, I'm believing that. That's a big assumption. Your model can be second order also, third order also, but you need to take this kind of assumptions while you're solving the problem. Okay, I'm assuming it's the first order. And I don't know the parameters A1 and B1. But I have the system in hand, so I'm conducting experiment and collecting this data at various instants of time k. So I'm plugging in those values in my system of equation, okay, and I have a big matrix like this. So this is, these are all the regression variables they call. Okay, regression variable. So what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to fit some curve. Okay, so I'm trying to find the parameters. Okay, I'm trying to find the parameters A1 and B1. So when I'm going for a line fitting problem, I will be accumulating the error, but this is a problem of what? It's more like this, na? Y equal to mx plus c. Okay, so what kind of problem are you trying to identify the parameters m and c? Okay, but it in form of a difference equation. Okay, so now, yeah, we got the error points. All these points are there. How we approach this? This stage, what do you do? This is a cost function. So we already know that the cost function has to be minimized. Why the cost function has to be minimized? Primarily because the error has to be minimized. How do we define the error? Y minus pi theta. What is this pi theta? That's the regression equation. What is this y? That's the experimental output you have got already. Okay, so we are trying to compare those two for each error. Okay, for example, E1, what do you get? Y1 minus pi theta. Okay, this pi theta is now going to be what? This value. Y0 into some initial value of A1 0. Okay, what is this theta? How do you give this theta? Anyone? This is A1 B1. So unless I know A1 B1, I cannot compute this difference. So how I am doing it? How I am getting the error? Any answer? You understand the question, what I am trying to pose to you? See, I am interested in computing the errors, okay? In order to compute the error, I have the experimental output, Y. I need to compare it with the regression expression like this. Okay, so for some past value of Y0 and U0, I need to predict the time series forecasting. Okay, I need to predict what is Y1. That expression is given like this. So I got two Y1 now. One comes from the experimental output, the other one comes from the regression theory, Y cap. This Y1 cap is nothing but pi theta. Unless I know theta, I cannot compute this. Okay, but I am looking for A1 B1. Then how do I compute this theta? Any answer? Fair guess? Any random guess answer? How do you give the theta? Yeah, another copy. Krishna, class number one, come on, wake up.
So can you repeat the question, sir?
Yeah. So there is the issue of finding out the error. Okay, this is why when we tap in neural network also we learned. So this is the experimental output Y at the instant 1, and this is the regression variable output at the instant Y cap. Regression equation expression. What is the regression equation? This is the regression equation. The regression equation is trying to predict the future value, okay, based on the past values. What are the past values? Y0, U0. But you need to know theta. What is theta? A1, B1. Because then only you can get this expression. Am I right? So from this equation, you can clearly see if I want Y1, what do I need to have? Minus A1, Y0, plus B1, U0. Second expression. So I need to know the past values. This value is available in hand. I'm trying to predict it. Who do I predict it? So going A1, B1. How do you get my error?
So randomly initialize.
That's what I'm looking for. The answer is you have to initialize it with random A1, B1 initial. Okay, initially initialize it with random A1, B1. Now you get an error, so this error is a big error like this. Huge error you are going to get. Okay, so this error is what this. So the next stage, big error I am going to have. The next stage immediately what I am doing, I am going for least square based solution. Least square means what? For what value of theta, A1, B1, the squares of error, okay, the squares of error, is going to have a least value. That's the idea of least squares. Okay, you understand the point what I'm saying? So for what value of theta A1, B1, my squared value of error should have a least value. So that's my expectation. I would like to minimize the error. So what I'm doing, I'm simply taking this expression, okay, vector matrix form, this form, vector calculus you have to employ. So it's more like y minus pi theta transpose y minus pi theta. So if you differentiate this with respect to theta once, I'm going to get, it's more like 2 times, okay, 2 times the 2 is going to come out, 2 is pi transpose y minus pi theta. So you need to employ the vector calculus rule, this one. Okay, when you have a matrix A multiplied with theta, you differentiate dou by dou theta, you're going to get theta transpose A theta transpose is going to be equal to A transpose. And only you get this. So that's why I'm getting a pi transpose here. Okay. So when I'm going to differentiate this pi theta, I'm going to have this pi transpose here. Then y minus y theta, that comes naturally from the 2 after you are differentiated. The entire thing is more like a square. Take the 2 out, so you get pi transpose y minus pi theta. So this idea is important. Once you apply this, the next stage, can you guess what you do? You like to minimize this dou j by dou theta. What do you do? Minimization of a cost function, what do? A quadratic cost function. Okay, a quadratic cost function. Minimization of it. Okay, what is that you do? Dou j by dou theta, you will equate to be equal to 0. So when you equate to be equal to 0, I'm going to have pi transpose pi theta going to be equal to pi transpose pi from this expression. After differentiating this once, I'm going to have this. And from this, I can take it out like this. Multiply inside. Pi transpose y, pi transpose pi theta. Take the 2 out. Okay, so in both sides you can divide it. So you get pi transpose pi theta equal to pi transpose y. So from that, theta is equal to pi transpose pi, the whole inverse pi transpose. This is a very famous least square based solution. Okay, this is your A1 and B1. So identified using this expression. So what is the difference between this algorithm and the gradient descent based algorithm we learned earlier? Almost same. What's the one difference you are seeing here? What is pi transpose pi inverse here? So I'm going to have an expression like this. Pi transpose pi. This is a pi. Pi transpose pi. Means you take this entire matrix, transpose it, multiply it with again the same matrix. So you're going to have expressions like this. Individually discrete values only now, so you can do that. Okay, take this matrix. We're going to have this. This is the matrix I have. So I can do this here. Here you see this form, a transpose form. Okay, so you can write this matrix in the form of the transpose. And then take this matrix, you transpose this matrix and then multiply it with the same matrix. So you can clearly see this. This is the matrix I'm talking about. This is a matrix I'm talking about. So what is that? That is pi. So if I transpose it, you can clearly you can see what you will be getting. Minus y0, okay? This row will become the column. Okay, you get y0, u0, okay? Then you go to next value y1, u1. The next value will be y of n minus 1, u of n. Clearly you can see that. Okay, that will be the transpose. And then you multiply with y0, u0. What do you get? So you're going to get the multiplication factors. Okay, y square, okay, for the k varying between 0 to n minus 1. In the same manner, if you multiply each and every term, you're going to have this second term, third term is going to be like this, first term is going to be like this. Okay. These are all the four terms you'll be getting. Then pi transpose y, if you do a, you're going to have this. Okay, this expression. Pi transpose pi, you can work out this. You can take the matrix and multiply and see, you get this. Okay, the summation series, here also is summation, pi transpose. And the theta value can be immediately computed. But the only thing, you have more number of measurements. For example, 1000 measurements. Then this matrix will be a huge matrix, Y0 to Y1000. This matrix will be huge, and finding out the inverses of those matrix will be difficult. Okay, so that's why we go for an online-based learning, iterative learning. Instead of storing all the data and then working out, that is the solution in terms of recursive least square based approaches. Then you can refer to that, recursive least square. But this approach, the problem is this matrix can be huge. Why? The regression variables, the n measurements increasing, it become bigger and bigger. This matrix will become bigger and bigger. Okay, so we're trying to fit random steps. Okay, so that's a so least square solutions. In fact, you'll be getting for this particular problem. Now let us take that in terms of the data set, easily you can understand. So here is the measurement. Okay, I have n6 measurements here. I'm interested in fixing a kind of expression like this. I'm interested in knowing A1 and B1. So this is UK minus one. So I got all the data. UK here is given as 1, 1, 1, 1 at various times. These are all the K values, these are all the YK values. So what do I need to do? I need to compute pi transpose pi, pi transpose y, then compute the theta using this expression. Okay. So we'll take the expression directly. So here is the expression, y transpose pi, k varying between 0 to pi, y square k, this is yk uk, and then the square k. So you can take all those values, I'll be computing the values like this. So you can do it in a leisurely manner. You can take up the data and plug in the values here and see you are getting this values. So direct the computation. Okay, you have to simply add. You can see it. So for example, this first one can be clearly y square 0 plus y square 1 plus y square 2 plus y square 3 plus y square 4. That's the first one. All these data for different values of k from the experimental data you can collect. Okay. Where is the experimental data? I have already given you. Data is see here, v of minus 1 is 0, 1, 1 by 2, 3 by 4, 5 by 8. You have to square all those values, okay? Simply that's all. That's the first term. Okay? That value is 3.106444. Next term, again, you can do it like this. K equal to, plug in the k equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 values. This minus is coming from what? Because the expression is, the minus is there. Remember that expression? This is your expression, minus y0. Why? The individual equation is y0 is minus a1, y minus 1, b1, u1. y1 is minus a1, y0, minus b1, u0. Okay, so you have to substitute those values. So that's why you are getting that minus there. Minus 1. Okay, so minus this one, and then this one. These two are same. Look at this symmetric form it is. So it is y square is u square. That's all. If you plug in all those values, quite easily you can get this expression, this matrix. Then pi transpose y is direct also. We can plug in values from k equal to 1 to 6, yk, u of k minus 1. K equal to 1 to 6, yk, u of k minus 1. Pi transpose y. And you got the expression here. Okay. So pi transpose. Clear. So then you can take the theta values equal to a1, b1, pi transpose pi, the whole inverse, pi transpose 1. The expression is what we have achieved, okay, using this method, the final expression. least square, least square solution is this. This is a least square solution. Pi transpose pi, the whole inverse, pi transpose pi. Okay, so that's the expression. So you can directly compute the values to be equal to 0.5 and 1. This is a pi transpose pi, the whole inverse, pi transpose pi, values of 0.5. So this can give you the model fit, okay, for your input output data. You are getting the point clearly, the implicit values you are trying to fit in. Okay, time as an implicit value. So you have, you are trying to mark points. In this case, input, output. Okay, we got data set with time as an implicit parameter. So this can be U1, this can be Y1, U2, Y2, U3. So you mark the points. Okay, you got a data and you're trying to fit a line now to this with the time as an implicit parameter. Okay, so it's the kind of dynamics you are talking about. Okay, so here they're kind of dynamics. So here the parameters are 0.5 and 1. Okay, so this is the kind of parameter you got. So the equation is going to be what? This equation will become now 0.5 and 1. So this dynamics equation is going to represent the data set. And you can predict using this dynamic equation. Predict or forecast. Getting the point? So that's what this idea is. Now, you would like to discuss anything now on this aspect? Do you understand how we are proceeding this problem? System of equations, we have so many number of equations, n equations. How many parameters to be identified? 2 parameters. 2 equations, let's see, n equations, 2 unknowns. The kind of problem we are talking about, multiple solutions will be had. Okay, so for that, what we are doing, we are going for the finding out this inverse. This kind of inverse, you can call it as pseudo inverse. Pi transpose pi, the whole inverse. This is a least square solution. So,
sir, your voice isn't audible, sir. Katachi.
Voice kekla sir konna oru 1 1 okay so that's it so pi transpose pi pi transpose y you need to compute and then direct so now tell me you have any difficulty in understanding this least square solutions how we are performing the linear regression okay using the least square solutions It's called least square solutions. Anywhere any difficulty? Okay. So this is basically the fundamental step before you go for the perceptron overload. In fact, I'm teaching it a little later. Okay. So linear regression, least square solution is a base. You look at the, this is a statistical base they call it. Statistical base for the learning theory. Of what? Regression problems. Okay, look at the slides again. Now we gain some more insight. How we are connecting this x and f of x. Okay, we try to pick models like this. Okay, so given some estimates for model position, we predict future states. Look at the computation data here. Hypothesis testing and all we'll see later. Okay, towards the end of the course, I'll teach you some basics of statistics and all. That time you'll understand. Okay, but right now, just get a feel of all this. This is number one, and I already told you the book also. This is a learning material you can read. So now we can read this difference between linear regression and logistic regression for a minute. Let me close this class. Linear regression is a supervised regression model. Logistic regression is a supervised classification model. Okay. Always there is a feel that logistic regression is also like regression, but it is not the case. To be very clear, it's a classification model, not a regression model. You are not trying to fit line or something like that, fitting curve, all those things we are not doing. We are trying to classify models. Okay, so using logistic neuron. The logistic neuron is what we have learned in the previous class. This is sigmoidal neuron. Any clarification required here? Am I clear here? Am I clearly conveying the idea? So here we have, there are two main classes of problem. One you call it as a regression problem. Another one you call it as a classification. Okay, these two problems are different. In the case of classification problem, we have a specific approach called the logistic regression problem. But after all, what we are performing is classification, not regression. So it's more kind of counterintuitive. That's why I'm spending some time on it. Counterintuitive. Primarily because as soon as you see the word of regression, you think in terms of regression, fitting a curve. I have a data, can I predict what is going to happen next? That is regression problem. Classifier is more like separating two different classes, drawing a line. Okay, these two problems are different. So, but logistic regression is a term used for classification problem with the neurons holding the transfer function, logistic and neuron. What is that function? Sigmoidal functions. Okay, you use sigmoidal functions. This is what we learned in the last class. Okay, 1 by 1 plus exponential of n. Remember, this kind of function we use, it's called logistic regression. And there, in fact, we are trying to separate two different classes. My one data may be here, another data may be here. So when I draw the logistic function like this, more like 0 to 1. So the probability of belonging to a particular class is what we are talking. We are talking in terms of the probability. So this is related to what? Maximum likelihood approach. So I'm making it clear. This stems from the logistic neuron and neural network approach, stems from maximum likelihood approach, which I will introduce you to. Then this approach, it is coming from regression, comes from least squared solution. Right now we have worked out the problem. Okay, least squared solution. Putting a curve, putting a line kind of problem. Okay, so two different approaches. And we also have something like linear discriminant analysis. That's what we learned under a perceptron neural network. Okay, discrimination function, you draw a line to separate. This is a sigmoidal curve you draw to separate, not in terms of probability you work out, but there are in fact no probability. We need a discriminant analysis. Okay, the perceptron case we didn't work out it. Maybe we will refer to this again. I don't want to bring in here, this one I have. Linear discriminant analysis, we'll see and then we'll understand. Okay, so this kind of classification, we will go through again through the book, okay, as well as through the video materials, as well as through some problems also, we'll try to understand it. So, regression and classification, any difficulty in understanding? You understand what is logistic regression and linear regression? This is linear regression. Can somebody tell me what is the difference? Basic difference between these two. Yeah. New one in the class. Okay. Is there any doubts, something to discuss? Stop here, today's class. We'll see you tomorrow, okay?